be afraid. Real simple song. I want to teach it to you tonight. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. I will wait on you. You, yes. I will trust in you. Yes, Lord, say. I will trust in you. Y'all help me. The Lord is my light. Everybody sing. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? You say it. Whom shall I be afraid? No, no. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? No, no. Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. Raise your voice. Hey, I will wait on you. Yeah. Say it again. Say, I will trust in you. Yeah. Sing. I will trust in you. The next part goes like this. Listen, I want you to go home singing this. I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord. Come on, you say it. I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord. The Lord is my light and salvation. Who shall I fear? Who shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Who shall I fear?
YouTube and other forms of social media. We thank you for being with us this morning. I'm here to share with us our word for this morning. And the text is taken from the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Let's read. It says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. And for the sake of our text, I want to repeat and thus reiterate verse 2. It says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this morning. Thank you for those that are joining us through social media. Father, we pray that as we declare your word this morning, we pray that you might open hearts and minds to receive the truths of your word. Help us, dear Lord, to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. These things we do ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. So today I want to share with you from this thought, fix your eyes on Jesus. You see, by doing so, I want to draw our attention to this conversation that takes place here in the book of Hebrews. And I believe that the subject by which the Hebrew writer is discussing here has to do with faithful Christian living and what it looks like on a regular basis. You see, to do so, I want to share with you briefly about the movie Overcomers. It was a beautiful movie. Perhaps you've seen it. If not, perhaps after the day, you'll go back and watch it. But in the movie Overcomers, there is this young lady who becomes a cross-country runner. But she attends a school, and she's a resident in this town where, sort of like Murphy's Law, where anything that can go wrong will go wrong. And so in this town and in this school, you know, problems after problem after problem begin to take place. And it's through the resourcefulness and creativity that this young lady is able to only not only accomplish her fears, but others in the movie are able to overcome their fears as well. And it's through their example that I think we learn a valuable lesson today, that when we fix our eyes on Jesus, we also overcome those fears that are haunting us. You see, I believe that not only is this depicted in the movie, but I believe also that this is depicted in the text, because the same is true about the people to whom the author of the book of Hebrews is writing. You see, in this text, in the lives of the audience that the writer of Hebrews is addressing, we find that they're filled with all sorts of fears. There is the fear that's led by the state, the fear of oppression by Nero. These Hebrews are stumped in their pursuit of Christian living and their pursuit of just everyday happiness and joy. Why? That's linked to the promise of a better life as a result of having trusted in Christ. You see, when they first believed the gospel and responded in belief, at first things were good. Things were going much better than what they had possibly hoped, much better than when they practiced Judaism. But as time continued, things began to change. The way people approached them and interacted with them began to change. All of a sudden, to be Christian, to live the Christian life, becomes not as joyous as it once was. And so for the audience in Hebrews, these people began to contemplate the possibility of going from Christianity back to Judaism. Why? Well, the writer of Hebrews points out in chapter 11, beginning around verses 35 through 38, he points out that this audience was being tortured in some of the worst ways. They were being sawed in half. They were being fed to wild animals. They were the spectacle of some champion gladiator weighed down by his armor and waving a powerful sword. These Hebrews, all of a sudden, they looked at Christ and Christianity and what it means to live out the Christian life. They looked at it differently now. And so, Still, they prayed to God. They practiced morality. They avoided foreign deities. They gathered in religious gatherings to hear the Torah. But what's new is they're being joined to both Jews and Gentiles. They are linked to a radical that was crucified because he spoke of an afterlife, talking about Jesus. They had become linked to
to this radical guy from Nazareth. And because of their association with Jesus, well, all of a sudden, they become the target of all those who are anti-Jesus, anti-Christian. And so they began to apostatize. They began to look back. They began to contemplate going from Christianity to anything other than Christianity. Because the future for Christians in this text doesn't look pretty. If just the fear of oppression wasn't enough, seeing friends and loved ones killed, that was enough to make anybody resort back to whatever form of living. So, life is not glamorous. It wasn't good being a Christian. Being Christian had its negative drawbacks. For some individuals, it's better to keep on practicing Judaism than to be subject to the harsh reality of being a follower of Christ. The apparent point noted in the text makes it needful for the author to point out to his audience what it looks like to walk by faith, drawing their attention to the faith of these cloud of witnesses. The writer of Hebrews takes the time to paint a picture in chapter 11, drawing on those individuals through the Old Testament who had received a promise from God. And they persevered. They demonstrated their faith on every hand. They may have died, but they went to their deathbed holding on to their faith. And so, the same is true for us today. In the world we live in, our world today greatly resembles the world of the Hebrews. Again, as I told you, Hebrews 11, 35-38, he depicts the horrific acts done against Christians. But also, in today's context, there's a group known as the Pew Research, and they've done this study. And the study shows that more than 15 countries today are hostile towards Christians. Not only that, in May of 2017, former Vice President Mike Pence was present at a conference on this same subject, on the subject of Christian persecution. And Mike Pence said these words, and I quote, "Throughout the world, no people of faith today face greater hostility or hatred than followers of Christ." You see, people today, we struggle. We struggle with publicly identifying with Christ. We struggle with identifying with Christ where? In the workplace, in the schools. We struggle with choosing the choice to worship or the shop because of the fear of harassment from outsiders. Individuals, families, and communities are divided along worship practices, sacred texts. Religious communities are divided. We're divided along religious affiliations, the afterlife, suffering, and the existence of God. Like the people in our text, it is the apparent struggle I see before us today by people who attend church, People who have the earnest of an intent, but they live daily under the sweltering smoke of fear. And so they struggle to live out the Christian life. They struggle to be guided by their faith. And so it's because of this that the question of today is apparent. I think the writer of Hebrews is asking us, and then he makes this suggestion. He's asking us as Christians, how do we live daily with fearful obstacles that threaten us in many ways? How do we live with all the fears, all the challenges, all the obstacles? How do we effectively encourage our kids to follow Christ? How do we live as Christian husbands and Christian mothers and Christian employees? How do we do it? Well, I believe the writer of Hebrews will make this suggestion to us. I believe he's saying to us that as Christians, when we process everything through the lens of faith, we triumph in a way that witnesses to the glory of faithful Christian living and the supremacy of Jesus Christ. The faithful life, or the life of faith, the faithful life, that is, the life that is filled with faith, is the only way to live. Therefore, it is the only one way to live that the Bible endorses. Let's jump into the text. We see here in verse, the author begins with this word. He says, therefore. And so when we see that word, therefore, it challenges us to go back. And so if we go back, we can chase this subject all the way back to Hebrews chapter 10, beginning verse 38, and we find that the writer of Hebrews picks up the pen and begins here in this discussion of faith, and he says that those who would live by faith, they will please God. You see, the writer of Hebrews is so convinced that the faithful life is the only way to truly live, that he has dedicated all of chapter 11 to shining the spotlight on people whose life was filled with faith and their lives please God. They live daily with a testimony to faith toward God. They lived in a way that through their faith, they understood the miracle of creation. They understood that by living by faith, we can and will obtain a good report. So for these Christian witnesses that we read about in chapter 11 of Hebrews, for them, there's no other alternative. There's no other possibility. There's only one way to live, and that is by faith. If you walk through chapter 11, you'll see it over and over again. By faith, by faith, by faith. He says, by faith, Abraham. By faith, Sarah. By faith, Moses. By faith, Jacob. Over and over again, the writer of Hebrews lets us know, and therefore he is imploring us to fix our eyes on Jesus. And when we do so, it is by faith that we persevere past all the fears that haunt us daily. But how do we do it? How do we fix our eyes on Jesus? And why do we do it? And what happens when we do it? What assurances do we have? What encouragement do we have? I think the writer of Hebrews is encouraging us in these three ways. I believe what the writer of Hebrews is doing is that he has done his homework. And so he's so convinced. He's fixed his eyes on Jesus himself. And so he's able to say to this audience, to fix your eyes on Jesus, because he knows the difference that the life of faith that's rooted in Jesus, he knows the difference that it makes in our lives personally on a daily basis. So, the author gives us these three encouragements that I think are present here in the text. He says, verse 1, he says, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, the first encouragement is, he says, they are reminded of what matters most, not in this life only, but in the life to come. When we join with these Christian witnesses, when we join with this cloud of witnesses that the Hebrew writer places before us, when we join in with the writer of Hebrews himself, we become a part of a larger community of faith. We have a whole community that's with us, that's cheering with us, that is before us. And their life is an encouragement to us that we're not in this thing by ourselves. And so we can do like the old hymn of the church says, we can march on, Christian soldier, marching as before with the cross of Jesus going on before. We become a part of a larger body. But not only that, I think he's encouraging us by, he offers us this encouragement by reminding us that when we fix our eyes on Jesus, we are a part of a larger community, but we also are reminded of what matters the most in this life. We're part of a larger community of faith. But this community of faith that we're part of, they also remind us of what's important in this life and in the life to come. In Luke chapter 12, verses 33 through 46, we find that the writer Luke is reminded that Jesus has promised us that one of the things that's important is that we be ready for his coming. It's not enough just to go through the motions, living life daily, but we have to live life daily in such a way that we are prepared, that we're looking for the coming of the Son of Man. When we fix our eyes on Jesus, we'll do just that. We'll be looking forward to, we'll be patiently awaiting his coming. But the writer of Hebrews, he also reminds us, we also see that this audience, this cloud of witnesses, they remind us of the hopelessness of the present world and the joy associated with the world to come. In Revelation chapter 21, we're reminded. John says, I, John, saw a new heaven and a new earth coming down from God out of heaven. Listen, when we fix our eyes on Jesus, We won't be distracted by the furrows of this life. Those things won't trip us up. Those things, yeah, they might grab our attention for a time, but we won't stay there. We'll persevere. We'll keep on moving forward. Why? Because we know that there is a better life. We know that God has something greater in store. We know that the troubles that we see that are associated and all the chaos we see that's associated with this life is temporary. Why? How do we know it's temporary? Because just like John said, I saw a new heaven and a new earth coming down from God out of heaven. And we know that we have a place prepared for us in God's kingdom. So we discover these things, and so we discover the liberty of not being burdened by sin. When we fix our eyes on Jesus, we do as the Hebrew writer suggests. We realize that we have this cloud of witnesses that are surrounding us. But also we realize that we have the ability of not being burdened, not being weighed down by the weight of sin. We can do as he suggests in the text. He says, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. When we enter into that joyous relationship with Christ, When Christ truly owns us, when he is mine and I am his, guess what we'll do? We'll take that sin and cast it aside. We don't want that anymore. We don't need that anymore. Those things, it's nothing compared to the glory which shall be revealed in us. It just gets in the way. It weighs us down. It hinders us from running the race that is set before us. Therefore, it's got to go. And so, we discover the liberty of being free from sin. And so, when we think about this idea of sin, when we think about the sin that so hinders us, you know, especially in this pandemic, especially in this COVID time that we're in, There's a couple of sin that's a little bit differently that we often don't necessarily think about. And they are, one, there is the sin of fear. You see, fear is contradictory to faith. You see, we find in Proverbs 28:1, he says, the wicked flee when no man pursues, but the righteous are bold as a lion. You see, when the righteous, When we persevere in faith, we're bold. We're like the theme of Star Trek. We boldly go where no man has gone before. My wife's gonna get me for that one, but that's okay. Listen. When we operate on faith and not fear, we live in contradictory to the world, but we live in accordance to the word of God. But when this sin of fear, when we allow it to remain in our lives, Proverbs 29:25 tells us that the fear of man brings a snare. But whoever puts his trust in the Lord will be safe. No, but not only is there the sin of fear, there's the sin of idleness. We find in 2 Timothy 3:10, Paul gives a boundary to the church. Paul says to the church, here, we need to place this restraint on the church. And what's the restraint, Paul? What's the boundary? What's the limitation that's given to the church here? Paul says that if there is any among you that will not work, Paul says, neither shall he eat. And so I ask myself, Paul says, we're commanding you. We're commanding you that If there's one in your presence, if there's one among the church at Thessalonica that will not work, then he is not to eat. Why in the world does Paul have the need to command the church in this way, to place this physical limitation around them? Well, it's obvious that some of the problems that were associated with the church in Thessalonica, all the backbiting, the gossiping and the busyness, the idleness that was taking place in this church, the failure to live out the Christian life. It was in part because of this thing right here. It was in part because there were some who wouldn't work, but yet they had needs. They wouldn't do their part to uphold their own needs and also to contribute to the welfare of the local assembly. But yet what they were doing is they were being a burden, they were being a strain to individuals. And so when we continue to allow those individuals not to work, but we give to them, well, then what happens is we begin to become codependent. It's through our willingness to feed them, we make it okay for them to keep on not working, but to keep on being busybodies. So Paul has to give them this instruction, give them this command, stop feeding that individual. If you stop feeding him, sooner or later he'll get hungry enough. Sooner or later, his stomach will start talking to him, and when his stomach speaks to him loud enough, you know what he'll say? He'll close his mouth, go to work, earn a living, and put some food in his stomach. But until then, it's not hurting him, it's not costing him nothing, and all he's doing is being a burden to the church. And so Paul says, look, I command you, don't feed his idleness. But not only that, there's the sin of apostasy. You see, these Hebrews went from Christianity to Judaism. They went from, Peter went from following Christ to fishing for food. Today we go from the overwhelming church attendance to no attendance at all. We've gone from multiples of ministry programs to a few basic voluntary events. There is the sin of substitution. Today we've resorted to worshiping the creation rather than the Creator. The humanist says, there's no wrong way to worship. The pantheist says that God is in everything. And so we've substituted worshiping the Creator. And so now we're worshiping the creation. Some of us, but the more we stay outside of the confinements of the local assembly, it gets easier. The thing, once upon a time, the things we wouldn't do on Sunday morning, now we find ourselves doing all those things. Less and less people watching the sermon on Sunday morning. Instead, we're out eating breakfast. Instead, we're out cutting our yard, watering the grass. It gets easier and easier. We're substituting, the sin of substitution. And so we discover then our place in God's eternal plan for humanity. When we focus our eyes on Jesus, we discover that we have a place. We have a place within the plan of God. Look in the text. He says, in verse 2, he says, Well, in verse 1, he said, let us throw off everything that entangles. And then he says, and let us run with perseverance the race that is marked out before us. We have a place in the eternal plan of God. Can I point it out? I want to point it out with these three words. He says, first there is the word run. Then there's perseverance or patience. And then there is the race. This word run emphasizes the urgency. You see, when we fix our eyes on Jesus, we remember when we first trusted Christ. Remember when we first began this Christian living. Remember the sense of urgency that we had to tell people. We say, hey, I got baptized today. We had a sense of urgency. Remember how urgent it was? We were, every time the church opened up, we were there. Anytime there was a need for some work to do, we were volunteering. We were signing our name on the list. Count on me. Anytime there was something related to the church, some business of the church that they needed to do, anytime there was a sick one that needed to be visited, we had a sense of urgency. We were there. But now, something's happened. Something's different. We've lost our sense of urgency. The more we stay away from the body of Christ, the more we hide behind the sacred camera, it becomes easier and easier. We don't know who's all watching. We can turn on our cell phones, turn on our social medias. We can let the thing run and walk away. And when it's over, it'll stop all by itself. So, what happened? Life happened with all of its fears, disappointments, and alternate interests. But look at this word, perseverance. Look, and so not only must we run, not only must we have this sense of urgency, but we've got to persevere. When we persevere, what happens? We find that when we persevere, we find our mark. When we persevere, we're not moved by trials. Instead, our character comes out. Who we are comes out in the face of fears. That's why the half-brother of Jesus, James, says to the church, that's why he writes and says, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh or produces patience. But then he says, let patience have its perfect work. Why? That ye may be entire, not lacking, wanting nothing. Look, when we fix our eyes on Jesus, we find our mark. We find out just who we really are. But if we turn and run at every fear, at every appearance of fear, We never discover who we are, who we are being made to be. We never live out the promise of Philippians 1:1-6, saying, being confident of this one thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. We've got to persevere. But now that if we run, if we persevere, then here's what we'll do. We'll discover our purpose. And the only way we can discover our purpose, if we've got to run the race that is set before us. My race is not your race. There's a race for me, and there's a race for you. Jesus likened it unto a cross. He says that if any man will come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and do what? He's got to follow me. Who's willing? Who's ready? Who would dare to take up their cross and follow Jesus? Who would dare to discover the race that's been marked out for you and to enter that race and run with perseverance? Here's what happens. When we run our race, we discover a life of purpose. Listen. There may be women who are listening to this video, who are listening to this sermon. Listen. There may be women who like Sarah and Hannah, their race included a closed womb for many years. There may be men, there may be fellas who are watching this video who are like Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Their race includes a dad with a life-controlling problem. There may be women watching who are like Ruth and Naomi. It's the day. Today is the day their worst fears became a reality. That's your race. There may be kids who, like the three Hebrew boys, they were forced to grow up fast in a place that's not their home. There may be men like Peter, who their race includes coming face to face with your own shortcomings. If that's your race, if you're like Hannah and Sarah, if you're like Ruth and Naomi, if you're like Peter, if you're like any one of these witnesses that have been set before us, listen, there is only one alternative. There's only one option. There's only one card to play. You only need to make one decision, and that decision is to fix your eyes on Jesus and run your race. Arthur says, verse 2, he said, let us fix our eyes on Jesus. He says about Jesus, he said, he is the author and the finisher of our faith. Listen. Fixing on our eyes on Jesus, it's the only guarantee of a life that pleases God. Can I press my point? Listen, somebody might ask, well, preacher, how do you know? How can you speak with such confidence? Preacher, do you have any assurance that the thing you're talking about actually works? Yes, I do. That writer of Hebrews, he was waiting for somebody to ask just that question. And here's what he wants us to know. The writer of Hebrews says to us that we can bank on the fact that faith in Jesus, when we fix our eyes on Jesus, is the only guarantee of a life that pleases God. How do we know it? Because Jesus is superior to everything and everyone else in every possible way. The writer wants us to know that Jesus is superior to Moses. He's superior to the angels. He is superior to all the priests that come before him. The writer wants us to know he's superior to Melchizedek. He wants us to know that Jesus brings to us he made a superior sacrifice on our behalf. What did he do? He didn't just offer any old lamb, any old goat, any old dove. He didn't just offer any old sacrifice for our sins. No. What the writer of Hebrews wants us to know that Jesus offered a superior sacrifice. How did he do it? He offered himself, his own pure blood, as a ransom for sin. But he doesn't just stop there. He wants us to know that because of what Jesus did, because of his sacrifice being so much superior, here's how that translates for us. Jesus is able to, he's able to fulfill the conditions of the old covenant, those conditions that neither one of us could live up to. But then Jesus, because he is a far superior priest, he sat down at the right hand of the Father on high, something that no other priest was able to do. He continually had to offer sacrifice for sin, sins for the people, and also for the sins of his own self. But what Jesus is able to do is, not only is he a superior priest, he's our high priest, but Jesus, he offers to us a better contract, a new covenant. He establishes this covenant with his own body. And so he is then the author and the finisher of our faith. And I told you about this the movie Overcomers. I want to go back to it for a second, because it's in that I think we see a perfect picture of Jesus. What we have then is Jesus isn't just a high priest who offered this sacrifice on our behalf and he sat down as his work is finished. No, Jesus is there on his throne in heaven. And what's he doing? He's making intercession for us. But not only is he making intercession for us, he's also cheering us on. He's marked out the life of faith. He's demonstrated what that life looks like. He's demonstrated how we go about pleasing God in this earthly life. The scripture says that though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. He demonstrated the life that pleases God by overcoming sin and suffering. But guess what he also did? Like the movie Overcomers, I love the part where in the movie the coach realizes how he can help Hannah to run her race. He realizes how her dad, who was an excellent cross-country runner, how her dad can be effective in the process. And he discovers their way to put Hannah and her dad together. And her dad is able to coach Hannah through his race, through her race. The dad knows exactly what she needs to do, knows exactly how she needs to take every turn, every challenge, every opponent, and be victorious at each occasion. And so Jesus, as we're running our race, guess what Jesus is doing? He's there with us, cheering us on, coaching us through the process, leading the way, encouraging us, persevering not only on our behalf, but what he's doing is he is standing on his own promises. He's there at the finishing line. And when we look over the hill, we can see him coming. We can see us getting closer to him, closer and closer to him as he's approaching. And Jesus, what's he doing? He says, come unto me, all you that labor, and I give you rest. He lets us know we can rest after the race is over, but we got to keep running. Jesus lets us know that hey, look, there is a rest. But not only there is a rest, there is a prize at the end. But we've got to keep running. So he is the author and the finisher of our faith. But also in verse 3, look at what it says. He says, consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Jesus did all of this. Why? He endured the cross. He endured the Pharisees and Sadducees. He endured his own people not really being convinced in who he is and what he said he'd do. He endured all of that. Why? So that he can demonstrate on our behalf the life that pleases God, so that when we enter our race, we have an example to follow. Why? Because he knows. He knows the fears that we have. He knows the heartaches that we go through. Scripture says about Jesus that he was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. He knows what we go through. He knows what it's like to be hungry. He knows what it's like to be in need of rest. He knows what it's like to want to be near to God, but feels so far away from God. How does he know that? Because when he was there on that cross, what did he say? He said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Jesus knows. And so he knows then how to lead us triumphantly in our race. But what we got to do? We've got to fix our eyes on Jesus. May God bless you, and may he keep you, is my prayer.